background, sir, since you are here, this initiative was started by a group of mentors of Atal Innovation Mission Niti Aayog, and this is getting broadcasted under the SAPU umbrella, where Ashin, Hardik, they are doing fantastic, you know, before pandemic, and of course there are a lot of things they are doing in this pandemic also. The sessions are getting recorded. The sessions are also going to be shared with across the schools which are coming the Atal Innovation Mission of Niti Aayog. So that is the precise background. We had 5 episodes. We started with Colonel Dr. Ram Athawale ji. Then we had Rahul Bhargav ji from Fortis. We had Sri Brijesh Singh ji, who is the IPS IG Mumbai Police. We had Suresh Prabhu ji. We had Kanwaljit Singh Bakshi ji, MP New Zealand. And last week we had Dr. Binti and Sanjeev Shivesh. Now, audience, I'll be introducing you, Professor Shastrabuddhi. Professor Anil ji finished his mechanical engineering with first rank and the gold medal. Subsequently, he obtained master's and doctoral degree, of course, with UGC fellowship from IISc. Currently, he is professor of mechanical engineering at Indian Institute of Technology, Guwahati, and joined AICT as a chairman in 2015. He was also a distinguished director of the COEP Pune. So currently, professor is currently working as a chairman and expert member on various national level committees. Some of these include chairman, basic scientific research, that is the BSR, empowered committee of UGC, SIAM board, definitely something I personally love a lot, and chairman board of governors of NIT Itanagar. He was also awarded with the Maha Entrepreneur Award in 2011. This is a very, very brief, but I would request, sir, if you can, you know, give a slight few abouts about yourself, that will be really enriching for the audience.
Oh, thank you, Amitav. Both Hardik and Ashwin have been doing great job as far as Atal Innovation Mission and connecting with students is concerned. And Atal Innovation Mission itself, I'm aware of Ramanan ji and also our Unnat Pandit. So they have been all doing great job as far as whether it is startup is concerned, movement for that, as well as for schools, tinkering labs, Atal tinkering labs are concerned. So I think I'm aware of some of the activities that have been done and how invigorating it is for our young students. So I reflect upon, you said you have to tell about yourself. So we were unlucky that we didn't have so many opportunities which current generation have. Right from handhold devices, that is smartphones, to laptops and PCs and television channels and education content. You talked about SWAYAM. I think all of this is absolutely empowering. So by sitting in any place, anywhere in the world, you can have access to the best quality education of all variety, you know, if it is in art, craft, design, music, dance, engineering, architecture, philosophy, you know, you name it and you have all the content available on the YouTube, on the internet. And therefore, this generation, we keep on calling Gen Y, Gen Z and Gen whatever, you know. So all of these generations have this feature which is very, very significant for learning. Now, we are talking about skills. You know, skills are very important aspect of life. Many a times we distinguish between general skills and the skills which are required by the industry, by the society outside, you know, after the education is over. So this kind of division, that there is something called a skill university and something called a general university, that itself has to dissolve someday. So both skill universities giving diplomas or degrees in vocational programs. And on the other side, those who are giving Bachelor of Arts, Commerce, Science, Engineering, which are called as general degrees. You know, both have to marry together. Unless one has the other component, the education is not complete. So we reflect upon the age-old system of Gurukula system or our own ancient university, Nalanda Takshila. Both were embedded so beautifully, the amalgamation, the blend was so beautiful that everyone was learning theory, he was memorizing also, but at the same time, actually doing work by hand, that what is called as experiential learning was one of the most powerful tools, and therefore education used to be complete. People have to experience what is happening in the world outside. And that is why in the new terminology, which we use today in our universities, one of them is called experiential learning. We also called some of them called as project-based learning. I think all of these are actually nothing but our own ancient and traditional knowledge system, where we had all of this. Somehow we missed the bus, there was a big gap, and now same thing is being indirectly reinvented. Now I will come back to some of the things which have been done. I will introduce in between myself later, you know, not now. So I would like to pitch something very, very important. So we have this National Skill Qualification Framework. The earlier version of that was National Vocational Educational Qualification, NVEQF. And from there, we graduated to what is known as NSQF, National Skill Qualification Framework, where we have 10 levels, actually. Level 1 and 2 is of the level of 9th and 10th standard. It's like an ordinary certificate. When you go to level 3, it may be of the type like ITI or 3 and 4. And if someone completes level 3, 4, 5, it becomes a diploma. If it is level 6, it becomes a post-diploma. If it is level 7, it is equivalent to a degree called as Bachelor of Vocation. While level 5 was Diploma in Vocation, level 7 is Graduation in Vocation. 8 and 9 is Master's in Vocation. And 10 is like equivalent to a PhD. You know, he's the master craftsman, actually. So something very high end. So we have created a framework. On the other side, we have formal education, which is class 10, which is a terminal in nature from the school education. We go into higher education, that is 11th and 12th. People take arts, commerce, science. That are the three major streams at the level of 11th and 12th. And then especially those who are in science stream, after 12th grade, they branch out into a variety of domains. You know, some of them will go into engineering, some in medicine, architecture, pharmacy. So the benchmark is class 12 science, you know, whether it is physics, chemistry, mathematics, and biology. I think this, and then you either do BSc, you either do Bachelor of Engineering or Bachelor of Technology, and then move ahead for Masters and PhD in those respective domains. So these two are sort of watertight compartments as on today. Although this framework itself, National Skill Qualification Framework, has enough opportunities both in terms of horizontal mobility and vertical movement. And that is what is significant. And that has to be practically implemented, which is not happening. Suppose someone has done a class 12 level skill, that means equivalent of class 12, which is level 4. He is still not the full-fledged diploma. Diploma is at level 5. So someone has completed level 4. There is a lot of general content of education in terms of theory, and there's a lot of practice content. Practice content is a major content in all these vocational programs in NSQF. But after going there, if he gets interest in mathematics and science, why can't he come into directly engineering college? You know, that is that horizontal mobility. In the framework, it is shown. But when you go to a university and ask that I want to join after my 12th grade in the vocational stream into a normal engineering college, there are a lot of roadblocks. I think that is one. And someone who has come into engineering, which is equivalent to after your level 4, you know, he's in the level 5 kind of a thing, and he finds himself, whether it is in engineering or science stream, that this is not fitting for him, and his more interests are practical, hands-on oriented. He must have easy access to get into level 5 of the vocational. That probably today also is allowed, you know, because there is less demand this side on the vocational front. And therefore, people from general education, if they come here, they may have to put in more work, but they may be welcome. But the other way around, which also has to happen, has not happened in the format, in the way it should have happened. I think this is the background. And now I will pitch myself. So I will connect it because my first job after I did my PhD from Indian Institute of Science, most of the people would probably go abroad for postdoc and good opportunities, greener pastures outside. I went all the way to Arunachal Pradesh, Itanagar, in northeast corner of the country, which was the remotest, you can call a technical school in the country, Northeastern Regional Institute of Science and Technology. And the model there was completely different from our formal education system. The admissions were after class 10. After you finish your class 10, you have an entrance exam for the northeastern states, seven states, and there was quota of 10% for each one of those states, and the balance 30% was for general. That means anyone who is from anywhere in the country, in India, or some of the officers who are actually not domicile of those states, but they have gone on deputation to those states, their children. So I think 30% for them, 70% for them. Now it is slightly changed because 8th state has been added to the Northeast, which is Sikkim. So it is 10 into 8, 80% that way and 20% this way. But the essence is joining is at the level of class 10 through an entrance exam. And the 2 years is called as a certificate module. Something similar also exists in many other parts of the country. We call it as secondary education, higher secondary education in vocational stream. There are some specialized schools where vocational education is important at the level of 11th and 12th with your normal physics, chemistry, math. So this is exactly the same way. So you study physics, chemistry, maths, and also one of the skill sets. You know, you may be in mechanical engineering discipline and you may do fitting, you may do carpentry, you may do welding, something like that. If you are in electronics stream, you may do TV repair or computer repair, something like that. Nice. If you are in computer science, you will do something similar. Electrical, you will do either motor, winding, generator, etc. No? So corresponding to the normal skill sets which are desired in that domain of engineering, hands-on ones are given in the first 2 years. And then those who qualify through that first 2 years of certificate and you graduate to a higher level, you want to go up, then there is an opportunity to join a diploma. And the diploma then is only 2 years. So they would have already put in after class 10, 2 years of a certificate program with hands-on skills. So their diploma is not a formal 3-year diploma after class 10, but 2-year diploma after indirectly class 4. So in fact, they put in 1 year extra, in fact, to get the diploma compared to the other diplomas which are offered in the different state technical boards. So this 2-year diploma has a mixture of theory content of the engineering discipline. And those who have done welding or carpentry or fitting, etc., machining, they will come into mechanical engineering. Those who have done electronic skills, they will go into electronics diploma. After 2 years of diploma, further those who are interested and who are found to be good, they will get into a degree program, a 2-year degree. Now, some of people will get puzzled, how can a degree be given of engineering in 2 years? But they have already slogged for 4 years before. So it is after class 10, 2+2+ next 2 years, which is same as 2+4, which is there in the formal degree program in engineering in the rest of the country. So I was excited by this kind of a philosophy because if you start with hands-on, with first 2 years module and learn the skill sets, and then go into the theory of it, why and how of it, I think you will understand it much better. You will be able to perform better. And this model was an excellent model. So I was attracted. Having done my PhD, I landed up in Arunachal Pradesh. For 8 years, I did that. By the time next IIT started in IIT Guwahati, so I went to IIT Guwahati. And after serving for 11 years, I got an opportunity to serve in College of Engineering, Pune, which is the second oldest engineering college in the country, as a director of that institute. And there I realized many other skill sets. So you learn also yourself, in the process of your life's journey. And that is one institute where already there were about 15, 20 clubs, variety of clubs. And they're all development of different variety of skills. You have an astronomy club, so you get interested into that, you can join that. There is a boat club, you learn, canoeing and boating and all that in that club. You have a sports club, of course, everywhere there, music, drama, dance is there. You don't imagine that in an engineering college, there is a philosophy club, a history club, and so on and so forth. So I think holistic development of a personality begins there. So I had a great opportunity there. Finally, I landed up in AICT as the chairman. And all that learning of my previous 30-odd years has been put to practice in AICT. That is in brief. I think I have explained more than what was necessary possible.
This is phenomenal. There are a lot of technical insight. You know, इतने सारे चीज पता नहीं चलता है काफी सारे बार. But thank you for you know spending quite a good amount of time. It was I'm sure this is insightful for all the audience. And especially on behalf of the mentors of Change Atal Innovation Mission, a special thanks to you because you put certain appreciation words that will be quite enriching for all of us. I'm sure. A special note of thanks to all our supporters before I go to the first question. NMIMS, IIT Kharagpur, Radcliffe Life Science and the European Medical Association, International Association of Medical Basics and Social Scientists, Dronalaya and UPCO, a PSU set up by Government of UP. They are the one who are supporting us. Sir, my first question will be, right now, if I see the online higher education has been around for more than a decade now, it's not something that we are reinventing, but it is already there. But why do you feel that why did it not take over the conventional education system in the pre-COVID era? Why is it not a norm already in India? And when the rest of the world was already showing this as a trend for the last many years? But what is your opinion on it?
Now, I think technology percolation to different developing countries has been always having a gap actually in terms of time lead, you know. They have already got the lead in terms of a variety of technologies. And that is one reason. Second reason is the infrastructure that is required for communicating through online mode, where you require high bandwidth internet connectivity to all the nooks and corners. So naturally, in the developing countries, the processes are taking a little more time. And this is not the case of India alone, but in fact, India has done much better than many other developing countries. I will reflect again. I would like to give example. Although we talked about a decade old of existence of all of these tools, that is online education, MOOCs platforms, and so on and so forth. My own very rich experience back to College of Engineering, Pune, I am very thankful to that institute and the chairman of the Board of Governors, Dr. F.C. Kohli, who was the first chairman of the Tata Consultancy Services. He was the chairman of the board. He said quality education is important. And IIT is so near to Pune, but Pune college students, they are the ones who would have just missed IIT education by whisker. Now they would have probably appeared in the JEE, did not get through. So they take the best possible state government institute that is available. And in every state, I think there are 3-4 state government institutions which are almost near to either NITs or level of IITs. But they, in terms of quality of students, I'm talking about. And then they miss out on the best faculties association. So we started what is known as online classes of IIT Bombay directly to College of Engineering Pune students. Remember, it is 2006-07. Even none of the online courses had started. It was the vision of Dr. F.C. Kohli. We had video conferencing equipment which had come in place. We placed 3 of them in IIT Bombay, 3 of them in College of Engineering Pune, and live classes of IIT Bombay were given to our College of Engineering Pune students. So they were attending, they were able to ask questions because it is live classroom. So like IIT Bombay students can class a query in the classroom, students of Pune could ask a question to the faculty of IIT Bombay because it was a live interaction. But that was the beginning. Just one and a half years later, the Khan Academy became popular. Subsequently, we had the MIT and Harvard's edX platform has come into place now. Coursera has come, Udacity. Now there are hundreds of online programs. They are all post 2007-08. So 2006-07 is the first experiment. Probably people have to record in history. This is in the world that between IIT Bombay and College of Engineering Pune, this did happen. Thanks to the vision of our chairman, F.C. Kohliji. So having said that, in India also, about 3.5-4 years ago, the platform for India's MOOCs, which is called SWAM, Study Webs for Active Learning by Young and Aspiring Minds. The long form of SWAM is Study Webs for Active Learning by Young and Inspired Minds, SWAM. And in our Indian languages, whether it is Hindi, Sanskrit, Kannada, Marathi, Telugu, SWAM is self. So for self-learning, this platform was created. In fact, as soon as Modi came as Prime Minister, probably the first 1 year itself, this cabinet decided that we must have our own MOOCs platform. And there were some you know, trials and errors and did not happen. And finally, AICT was given this responsibility. With the help of Microsoft, this was done. So it is over 3 years old. It's not that we are lagging. We have got 2,500 courses, 1.2 crore registered users, and 114 countries are watching our courses. So it is not that we are lacking. But certainly, in terms of numbers, in terms of quality, in terms of the bandwidth, the some of the platforms abroad, they are far better than us in terms of even quality. So I think that is where we need to further improve and also have the spread right up to a remotest village in Nagaland, remotest village in Jammu Kashmir, and a tribal area in Chhattisgarh, Jharkhand. I think that is where we are still lacking to some extent, that our internet connectivity, hardwired fiber has to reach, like we have attempted at reaching electricity to all villages, bandwidth and internet to all villages, every hamlet, every home. I think that is the vision. If you do that, I think education is at the doorsteps. So you can do it through your mobile phone. You can do it through your computer or laptop. Then we would have really achieved a great deal of skilling as well as higher education to everyone.
But sir, if I see the MOOC and the SIAM, it was already there. Of course, there are not much people who are aware about it. Unfortunately, now after this pandemic, majority of the people has come to know. In fact, I still remember, so I think you might be aware, Professor Sahastrabuddhi of IIT Bombay and Professor Sridhar Iyer was also part of it. So last, I think it was a year back when me and Professor Sahastrabuddhi were sitting in the Starbucks and we both were actually went inside a very in-depth talk on SIAM and the MOOC. We both forgot to order coffee and he went back after the meeting and we both were laughing after that. And then he was saying, Amitabh, you know, trust me, someday will come when people will realize the MOOC and all. So we're just having a chat couple of days back and now that probably that day has come. But what do you feel? Why it was not much popular before pandemic? What was it? It was missing something or probably the push was not there or people failed to realize it? Or probably this is going to be another game changer right now. What's your opinion?
There are two, three reasons again for this as well. So the MOOCs were started in big way. For 3 years, and both UGC and AICT already mandated that 20% of the credits can be taken from out of the MOOCs courses. So your own university curriculum, out of that, whatever courses are there, some of them, those where you don't have good quality faculty, at least you start taking them from the MOOCs, including examination through MOOCs, and then finally credit them into the transcripts. So this empowerment also is made for about last 2 years. Number of people using has gradually increased, but number of users have certainly increased, but credit transfer has not increased. So one of them is the really making them aware that such a provision exists. So many times, you know, we don't advertise too much. You know, we keep quiet and we send some circular, etc. It doesn't happen. Secondly, many of the universities have to adopt the MOOCs courses as part of their curriculum, as part of their, transfer of credit. And for that, their academic councils and all have to meet. And this kind of bureaucratic, you know, processes sometimes come in the way. Third one, many faculty who are already there in the college or university in that domain, they sometimes may be feeling threatened. If this MOOCs course is taken by students from an IIT Bombay faculty or IIT Kharagpur faculty, what will happen to my job, you know? So this kind of is a psychological, pressure also exists. Fourthly, the percolation of technology or use of technology down the line is not as predominant as the younger generation. You ask, forget about college going student. You even ask a fifth standard, sixth standard boy, he knows how to handle the computer, how to handle various MOOCs courses, what type of games are there, what type of are useful, and where to go, how to fix it. I think they are smarter than even the college students, and college students and university students are smarter than their faculty. And this phenomenon that we can also learn from students, I think this philosophy has to be an important thing. What you say, attitudinal change in the faculty is to be brought about. Now, it is not the same as 25, 30 years ago, because we had access to only libraries. and a faculty member would have done his master's, PhD, would have gone through many courses. So he had already inbuilt knowledge into his brain, and he was able to deliver that in the classroom. Students had to hunt for books and then start and study that. And many books were always booked by some student. You will not get access to the book for 1 month, 2 months. All these things were there. Even Xerox machines did not exist long time ago. So I think from there, we have come to a place where knowledge is available at our disposal, you know, information. But now faculty need not be worried. What students know is information. Transforming that information into knowledge and knowledge into wisdom. That is the role that the faculty have to play in terms of being mentor, in terms of being a person who can coordinate, collaborate with the student and get him go along and become a better student for him also. And both of them can become students together, actually. I think this has to be embedded into our teachers. And that is what was missing. So I think these are the three factors where it has not become popular. But now when the classes abruptly stopped, it is not only using the material from the MOOCs platform like Swayam or TV channel, 32 direct-to-home channels under Swayam Prabha, which students are using today in the lockdown period, but many colleges and universities have their own learning management system, as well as their own lectures being beamed by themselves. This is also happening. So this phenomenon was not necessary earlier, and that's why people were coming to the classroom in the physical mode and continuing the classes. Now that there is no other way than this, so naturally people have started using it. I think we would be probably the earliest adopters than anywhere else in the world now. Now you see the development in the next couple of years, we would be far ahead of anyone else.
So sir, you were talking about the faculties. And if I go by that logic, the faculty still remains same pre-COVID versus pro-COVID. Only thing is that the implementation of the technology has a lot of stuff. And we all agree that there are a lot of challenges the institutes and the faculties are going to say. So do you feel or probably you are thinking to have some kind of, you know, faculty development program or probably as a train-the-trainer program across the country, something like that?
We are already doing it in a very, very massive manner. In fact, the numbers will be mind-boggling. I would like to, just because you asked this question, I will tell you that soon after the lockdown began in the March, say 22nd, 23rd onwards, we put ourselves into the shoes of the students and faculty and tried to see what is required to be done. We didn't know that time the lockdown will remain only 3 weeks or beyond, you know, and finally it remained for about 3 months now. So we started early enough and we experimented on few workshops in the beginning. Experimented on ourselves, because most of the faculty development programs we used to conduct were all in face-to-face mode. And in every such faculty development program, we used to have about 50 to 60 faculty members because they had to travel, they have to have accommodation, food, etc. arrangements. Cost was also there. So therefore, we used to restrict to 50 to 60. Then we said, why not prepare an online? First, a workshop of that nature we started was on universal human values. We have a student induction program and a course on universal human values. And we started that with AICT officials themselves. And we found that it is as effective as a face-to-face mode. Maybe one or two of them will in between go for a cup of tea, keeping the camera on or off or whatever. Some such things may happen. And that can happen in the classroom as well. Many of the students in the classroom, their attention is not there because they may be thinking something else. So to the same extent, as far as a learner is interested in learning, whether it is in online mode or whether it is in face-to-face mode, we found that there is no difference. We have to keep them active by giving intermittently some quiz, etc. So they remain proactive in the classroom. So this is one experience. Then we said, why 50-60? When one shot we can reach out to more people, shall we try that? We started with 150, then 200, then 300. We went in some of the workshops to the extent of 1,000. There are workshops which we conducted for examination reforms. I think that is another interesting area which AICT has started 3 years ago. And that is examinations, which were all earlier based on rote learning. How can we have question papers which are of higher level of learning testing or evaluation? That means whether a student has understood the concept, whether he is aware of the knowledge of that system, whether he is able to apply that to some related field, whether he can synthesize a problem, or a solution, whether he can be creative. I think such questions are not asked except in few IITs, especially in the open book examination, such questions are there. But otherwise, if you look at most of the question papers from our KG to PG, I say KG to PG always. So in KG also, A for apple, B for ball is, you know, rote learning. And that is the question and that is the answer expected by the student. So if you move away from that, we will have real innovation happening. And that is how we have this examination related workshops. We reached as much as 1,000 audience. But effectiveness is not as good if the numbers are too large. So finally, we have come down to a standard that is 200 to 250 is the optimum number where you can have an absolutely effective faculty development program. Now, last year, we started what is known as under Atal Academies, AICTE's Training and Learning, ATAL, Atal Academies. We have courses on AI, IoT, machine learning, deep learning, robotics, 3D printing, cyber security, cloud computing, augmented reality, virtual reality, blockchain. So all these upcoming areas, emerging areas, we wanted first to train our faculty in those. So we had already started last year in the face-to-face mode with 200 as the target. We could complete 185 and the COVID-19 crisis made us to stop that. But in 185 workshops, we could touch 9,860 faculty members.
Wow.
But in the last 3 months, we have only held 85 workshops and we have reached 18,000 plus faculty members.
Wow.
Double the faculty with half the number of workshops. I think that is the power and strength of technology, which we have exploited fully. We had Universal Human Values, 16 workshops for vice chancellors and other academic leaders, etc. We had examination workshops, we had research workshops. I think all variety of workshops for training are already in place. Not only that, one of the important things, as I said, attitudinal change and all that, we have had a mandatory faculty certification program launched 2 years ago. Now it is fully available even on the MOOCs. All the four NITERs, National Institutes of Technical Teachers Training and Research Institutes, Chandigarh, Chennai, Bhopal and Kolkata were given this task, and the committee was headed by Professor Khincha, the former Vice Chancellor of Visveshwara Technological University in Belgaum, and also Professor of Eminence from Indian Institute of Science. So he, under his leadership with a committee, have given a teacher's certification program, what are the modules required? And we have developed MOOCs courses on that. And unless a teacher in the first 5 years does not do them, qualify, go to industry for 1 month and learn industry practices. And all that he has learned, he practices in one semester under the tutelage, guidance, mentorship of his senior faculty. He will not be given a certificate. And till he does not get a certificate, he will not become a regular faculty. I think I have answered elaborately how we are trying to bring on teachers in various facets. One of the modules out of those 8 modules is use of ICT, innovation, research. All of these are embedded. And if faculty goes through these modules, naturally he gets empowered and he will be in a position to implement that in real practice when he starts the teaching profession.
Great. Thank you, sir. It was a quite elaborative answer. In fact, before I go to the next question, audience, you can start writing the questions. Please do not write any controversial question. Try to utilize.
No problem. I am used to answering controversial questions.
So I always start controversial question. But let's utilize the platform for the most of the learning, because the majority of them are probably associated with academics or associated with the kind of lot of schools. So it will be great if you can stick to our kind of learning. That will be best for all. So in fact, I have one interesting question. I think that is already, you have already covered. So Amrita Mukherjee is writing that, sir, in the ancient educational system, development and values like learning to know the inner self was important. How this type of skill development will be possible in virtual system of learning? The question is quite relevant because every faculty is not capable enough to handle the virtual learning in the same way. So you already answered that probably, if you can keep up the same interest level and, values is also possible. But the probably the faculties who are handling in a remote situation where there is a connectivity problem and all. So how they can ensure that the skill also gets built up in the way they used to teach pre-COVID era?
I think I have been reading also the chat box actually, and I'm combining one or two of those questions and what you asked together and then answer that. So I think what that particular faculty from Amruta, whoever it is saying, is absolutely correct. I fully endorse that. That skills, and especially practical skills and values, they cannot be in the form of a video lecture or online mode. For that, you need actually face-to-face mode for two reasons. It is not even in the face-to-face mode, a faculty who is taking that, if he himself does not have those ethical values and honesty and integrity, he has no right to teach that. And such teachers, when they teach, students will laugh at that and they will not inculcate those habits. And therefore, while it is important that we must have skill building as well as value-based education building, value building through face-to-face mode, even selection of faculty for that is very important. They may not be very experts in some humanities course. They may be a person from science background, maybe from engineering background or a medical background. One who is absolutely dedicated in his life in terms of honesty and integrity, and who practices those values which he is preaching. Unless it is followed, I don't think values can be inculcated. They are always observed. And we start from our childhood. In fact, forget about colleges. We start from our families, mother, right, father, how they behave, what they tell and what they practice. You know, child starts learning from there. And therefore, values are one which are always imbibed by looking at some others. And therefore, even if an institute or university has 5 to 10% of the faculty who are absolutely ethical and value-based, and if they take up these classes, I think we will be able to reach out. And therefore, I am endorsing the view that everything cannot be online. We need online as well as the face-to-face. And a new blend has to happen. You know, blend is of online education, maybe 20% credits, 40% credits. But some of these things have to be in the face-to-face mode, in the infrastructure. You need also other facets of human life. It is not that ethics is taught in a course. You know, you have a playground. You have the team spirit to be built. You know, two teams are there. How do they behave? Sportsmanship spirit. Then you have drama, music, art, dance. All of these teach a student certain facet of life. I think this human learning is very, very important. And therefore, as soon as this COVID-19 is over, we must come back to our classes. We should have that. And till that time, we may have a mixed mode. Some 1/3 students will come to the class. Remaining 2/3 will observe through the classroom, through the internet and the online mode. And some other 1/3 students come in the next one week. And we may have to develop new innovative models while maintaining social distancing. How, as a human being, we call ourselves as the highest species. Homo sapiens is the highest of the species. And we are called also social animals. No animal world has so many social functions, whether it is birthdays to marriage parties to festivals to various types of organizations like drama, music, dance. No other animal world kingdom does it. And therefore, we must come together. We must meet each other. But today, the crisis is of a different kind. So we have to navigate this problem with a sense of responsibility as well. And therefore, we must not reject online, but we should not say everything is online.
Sir, on the same line, now, of course, till the time things get normalized, online is the only way. But there is a huge challenge of the connectivity in the remote areas. You know, I remember in my Bangalore days when I used to go pass through this Hubli, Dharwar and other parts, right? So there are a lot of fluctuation happens in terms of the connectivity. So in those areas, how do you feel that things can be taken up?
My dear friend, I'm in Delhi, in the heart of Delhi, which many TV channels call as Lutyens Delhi, adjacent to the High Court building. And in my home, internet connectivity drops down suddenly. I have 3 connections and all 3 fail sometimes. That is because the usage has increased phenomenally in this period. Otherwise, in the normal period, 3 months back, I had never this problem. In fact, problem increased not because there is a poor quality of service. The number of people, because of lockdown, everyone is using, and our pipeline is fixed actually. So we have to increase the bandwidth, you know, in terms of not gigabyte connectivity, terabyte connectivity. This is number one. Number two, we have different infrastructure projects for roads, railways, airports, something similar on a mass scale by the government in order to reach. We already have BharatNet, and there is a claim that we have almost reached all the villages in the country. Like we have electricity to all the villages, which has been achieved, you know, over 70 years, you know, and last mile was achieved very recently. Our government announced that now the electricity is there to all villages. We must also confidently say every village has the internet connectivity. Further, it should go to every home and hamlet, but that may take little more time because of both cost-wise as well as the strength that we have in terms of building that infrastructure. It will take time. But at least even if it goes to every village, why not have one common center in every village? You know, we have marriage halls, we have temples, we have churches, we have various social organization institutions, sports complexes, where we can put in one computer with network connectivity, high bandwidth connectivity, and few computers which are connected with that. This is one model, and people can come there and continue to have the education. Second model, all smart devices have the internet connectivity these days. You know, you have some data plan required. So some of them are not capable of buying. Why not all middle class, lower middle class, upper middle class people, and also of course higher middle class and rich people. If you search their homes, I will tell you there are at least 4 to 5 smart mobile phones of last year, last but one year, lying idle in our homes. I will challenge that someone will say, no, I don't have. There will be at least 4 or 5 phones. Most of us would have changed hands actually. And the old one will be lying, either we throw it and it will become electronic waste, creating environment hazard. On the other hand, if it is functional, fine. If it is not, spend some money on that, fix it up, and hand it over to a library of a school or a college, and they will in turn distribute like books. I think we can empower entire population of our country with the smartphones through which they can access this content. And last but not the least, some data plans must be free for some financially poor background students. Government can even think about direct beneficiary transfer. You know, someone who buys a data plan of 500 rupees a month, he gets it back. I think there are various ways. And then I had a meeting with NASSCOM. They committed that most of the IT industry, they change about 500,000 computers, means laptops, every year. They can donate this to our poor children. So I think we can overcome digital divide very easily.
Great, sir. Now, my next question is related to the safety parameters. Since everybody is using this computer and the parents and child, there are a lot of talks are going on. So what is your view that the technology, does it protect the child, prioritize the privacy, and safely store the child data? So a lot of concern are going on right now.
See, data privacy is one of the very important ingredients, because of which even our Aadhaar card has been not allowed actually. But with some restrictions, my personal opinion is Aadhaar is a very powerful medium which has been developed by the government of India. One of the largest databases anywhere in the world, with all kind of checks and balances, if we are able to make use of that, that is number one. So the privacy of the individual is also maintained. And secondly, what kind of material children are using, etc., is all depends on how parenting is done. Actually, if you restrict and say that this is not allowed, that is not allowed, a young mind is always in the mold of revolt. You know, you can see that age group from about 7, 8, 10 years to about 18, 20 years is a age of revolt. You know, for anything what anyone says, they will always say that I will do other way around. So I think, therefore, sensitizing our younger generation, talking to them as friends. See, as soon as you show authoritativeness, parents showing that, you know, my child, you cannot do it. So there is a revolt. Whereas you act as a friend. Same is the case with teachers. As soon as teachers will be friendly with the students, they will accept everything that you do. I think that is the phenomenal power of the teachers. I think we have to use that. And in fact, I remember my own children or many other of all of us who have got children, they would have experienced this in the young age, between about 5, 6 years to 10, 12 years, in the class 1 to class 5, 6. if parents say you have to do this mathematical sum this way or science is like this, they will simply say, no, my teacher has said like this, that is the correct way. Even if the parents are highly educated, children will not listen to them. So teachers are a powerful tool for creating the new generation in the right mold. And that we must do it. And that's why our faculty certification program have all these contents. How we have to handle our children, our students.
So on the same line, since end of the day, the online education is both applicable for the higher education and the school, that is the K-12 segment, right? But the user base is very different. What will be your advice towards the school education system as a structured implementation of the online environment? Because there are a lot of R&D is going on by a lot of trainers and all, but your advice will be very useful for the school level.
I think school level coming together in the school is more important than higher education. In fact, many of the traits which are some of the questions who asked about values, ethics, etc., they all get created during the impressionable age. Actually, once you pass that, bringing in something new is more difficult. Similarly, learning multiple languages is easy at the young age. So at our age, you ask us to learn French or Italian, probably it's very difficult. You put a child of 7-8 years to an Italian class, within 1 month, he will master Italian. So therefore, coming together of our young students, they will learn all our Indian languages, 22 languages. There is always fight sometimes, why 3-language formula, why this language? I will tell you, between the age of 5 to 10, you teach them as many languages in a different manner. Don't ask them to learn the script, writing, reading, etc., but tell stories in those languages. They will pick up the language and some of them will get interested in a particular language. They will learn the script. They will learn writing, reading, everything. So I think that is the way our school education has to handle. Therefore, we must come together. And for that, online has to be as limited as possible. And to provide that opportunity through online, which is not possible during the face-to-face. Because every school cannot have an expert, maybe in painting, maybe in dance, maybe in history, in math. There will be teachers, but some of them are good in some subject, but you don't have good teachers in some subjects. Or you may not have a teacher in some subject, but student is interested in learning. How does he learn then? Then every day if he comes to the class, such courses through the MOOCs platform, through the YouTube, through the internet, they must be advised to take them. And if you direct their attention towards better learning into newer and newer subjects, which are very interesting to them, actually, not your interest, their interests and their aptitude, I'm sure they will not be diverted towards looking at wrong kind of content onto the internet.
Thank you, sir. Since we are talking about school and we also covered higher education sector, now there is a common thread. The schools and the higher education sector both are trying to work for the new India, or probably India 2.0. And we all are talking about the Atmanirbhar Bharat right now. Now, Atmanirbhar Bharat is a terminology that has come post-COVID. However, that was already a boast like Startup India, Make in India. There are a lot of things are already there. So how do you see that the educational institute can contribute towards the Atmanirbhar Bharat? How do you see pre-COVID era versus post-COVID era in the innovation? If I talk about for India 2.0, how do you see that India can have the reskilling and the upskilling? So what are those areas you feel that the reskilling or probably the upskilling is needed? Or probably if I talk about somebody like me or somebody like another people, we can actually upgrade ourselves to the skill 2.0.
See, you are talking about post-COVID era. In fact, far earlier than pre-COVID era, about 7-8 years ago, but I talked about NSQF in the beginning when you started off. Then we have what is known as Prime Minister's Kaushal Vikas Yojana, Pradhan Mantri Kaushal Vikas Yojana. For those who are dropped out of the schools, we were providing different types of skill sets so that they become employable, useful to society rather than becoming, nuisance in the houses, actually. So that is what was being already done. We have skill knowledge providers who are selected, who provide skills to educational institutions. We have National Employment Enhancement Mission. We also have that. We have started for higher education mandatory internship. Like in medical school, unless you complete 1 year internship after your 4.5 years of education, you are not allowed to practice medicine. Whereas in engineering and many other professions, you become a graduate and start practicing. So I think we have introduced what is known as mandatory internship in industry. Industry does not necessarily mean only the large industries like Maruti Udyog or Tata Steel or the TVS Suzuki and so on, so for Infosys, TCS, but also medium scale and small scale industries, startups, or even going to villages under Unnat Bharat Abhiyan, trying to find out challenges there existing and how your knowledge can be applied. All of this is nothing but internship, which is outside the domain of the classroom. You go out in the world outside, see what are the things happening, learn from those experiences. I think that is the holistic development of that human being. So this is all being done, not in the COVID era or post-COVID, much before pre-COVID era itself. So I think we need to strengthen. Just 3 months before COVID, you know, in November, December, we came out with what is known as a NEET platform, National Educational Alliance for Technologies. And these are very interesting software tools which are developed by mostly, you know, startups and some of them by large companies as well, which provide skill sets to our individuals, which are based on artificial intelligence based personalized and guided learning. I think without going to a class or college also, through these tools, you test yourself where you stay or where you are today, and then it will guide you through some learning material and it will keep on testing and take you through that course, whereby you get skilled in one of those areas, which I already mentioned earlier, AI, IoT, machine learning. These are all upcoming niche areas. And why only higher education institution students? This can be done by even primary school, high school students, because they are today so smart, they will pick up very fast and then will be able to become Atmanirbhar Bharat's early, what you say, volunteers or jawans. You know, I call them new jawans, actually, in terms of Make in India was already there, but Atmanirbhar Bharat is the India 2.0, yes. Make in India 2.0, you can say. Because many things they're being manufactured or done here, but how we can really become self-sufficient, don't import those wherever possible, and then, in fact, export those. And this strength we do have. We have not explored that fully, and this is a time that we should explore that.
Right, sorry. On the same line, I have an interesting, in fact, two questions which I'll be combined together. So the question is, being an early adopter of MOOC platform, I always wonder that if we can have some platform to deliver vocational training to start street food stall, mechanic, repairing skill, this will help people to start small business. And now, since direction from government is toward Atmanirbhar Bharat, what is your view on utility platform of this kind? With, I'm just combining another question with that. Another person is writing that I would like to understand your views on soft skill building through online platform. And how do you see an idea of inculcating soft skill through collaboration with private or public companies and working through active interaction with them? Probably some combination with MOOC as well as a kind of, probably it can go under CSR or some other PPP model, if that works.
No, in fact, whatever I talked about NEET, NEAT, the National Educational Alliance for Technology, these technologies do have your content where learning of language of English, that is already there. Soft skills is already there in that embedded. There are many other soft skills in terms of team building. They're all part of that. But secondly, more importantly, there are many who are not onboarded onto this platform, may come in the due course of time, because we had only first version. NEET 2.0 is going to be launched very soon, where we will have more opportunity for private players. We can bring them on fold. And this is not free. Please remember, what we started off was a very innovative idea, that many of these companies who started this product, they are beginners, actually startups. And we cannot ask them that you give everything free. A company like TCS or Infosys or Tata Steel, if you say that you have to provide something free under your CSR, they are in a position to do it, but not the startups. So this particular portal does allow charging of a fee. But what we have embedded into that, an interesting feature is, for every 4 seats procured by any student who is capable of buying this product, 1 seat has to be given free of cost, which will be accumulated, and AICT will offer it to low income and those deprived sections of the society, SC, ST, remote areas, and poorer children, free of cost, these free seats will be distributed to them. I think this way, the level playing field in terms of skilling is also possible. This is one part. And such tools, many of them are developing. Now, coming to your different types of hard skills, you know, in terms of, say, for example, welding, for example, driving, pilot, you know, flying an aircraft, there are many tools which are already available, which we call as simulation tools, actually. They actually simulate the virtual world, and you will be able to work on that, and you will get trained good enough, but not 100% capable of actually handling the real life. And therefore, this is a supplementary thing. You know, online skill development, what you said, in some certain domains can be to the extent of training them to the extent of 70-80%. And remaining 20% has to be necessarily on the hard machine. Say learning lathe, learning welding, learning carpentry. Many of these features can be trained, and you observe that continuously. And even some exercise, you can do it on the computer. Your movement of the hands, legs, etc., and then try to figure out how where you go wrong, etc. That's what the driving schools can do. Pilots are trained like that on simulators. But you can't allow a pilot who is trained on only simulators, straight away aircraft is given and 300 passengers in his hands. I think we can't do it. He has to sit on the aircraft along with a pilot as a co-pilot, observe everything online, and then sit on the pilot chair, and the pilot will sit on the co-pilot and tell him where what is going wrong, and then train him, and then only he can fly independently. So exactly the same way, all our skill sets where you require really hard skills, they have to be some part on the online mode, and the remaining in the real world, they should go and handle those equipment.
Great. Now, there is a very interesting thing that Sapio Umbrella is doing with Hardik, Ashin and other people. They have recently started and work on the new platform for the Shramiks. A Shramik Shakti Manch called Saksham. Through these, pan-India, skill gap of Shramiks are being identified through intelligent analytics. It's a very innovative thing they are doing. So do you have any thoughts on what new types of skills these Shramiks need to go through? It will be probably quite insightful for Sapio, that's for sure.
Man, I think there are, I can give umpteen number of possibilities, but one of the things which is very significant is testing of the students on his actual attributes, inherent attributes. We don't have such kind of a system existing, so it is in two types. So what is my real interest? Many times we ourselves do not know. So unless you give a variety of questions and ask him to answer, the person's interest is not going to be identified. So this is one area where a lot of intelligence can be used, which is called AI or machine learning, in order to identify that. Second part is the learning methodology itself. We have different learning styles of students. Someone will be very comfortable with teacher teaching in the classroom in the blackboard. Someone will be comfortable on the internet. Someone will be comfortable with actually working on a machine, hands-on. Someone will be by observing experiential learning. Some people can be using augmented reality, virtual reality. So all variety of students exist in our classrooms in that class of 60. How do you identify who is able to learn in what methodology better? You must be knowing there are mind maps. You know, some people will, whatever they understand, they will write it in the form of a map or a figure or a picture, and that remains in their memory for life, actually. So I think these kind of traits which are there inherently in every individual, which is different, each one cannot learn in the same way. So identifying such things through AI-based tools is another area which one can do. Then you come to skills. There are different types of skills. What component has to be, what percentage blend is required, one can identify that. You know, different skills will require different percentage. Even our higher education, when we are talking about online, which subject or which course can have more online and less face-to-face, and which course will require more face-to-face, will differ from university to university, college to college, course to course. I think there is huge challenge and huge opportunity for startups and other people to do that.
Sir, in fact, you have given me the clue for my next question, which is a very interesting question for you. See, there is always a conflict between the classroom-based versus distance learning. Somewhere in a typical mindset, the distance learning has been considered as inferior. It's a hardcore reality because जब भी बातें होती हैं, distance में पढ़ाई नहीं होती है. That was the earlier thought process. Now, the way it's shaping up, now everybody is talking about the importance of online learning because of pandemic and all. So probably I can say it's a blessing in disguise for the distance learning. Then how do you see that probably, you know, some thought process will be changed or probably still what will be the key differentiator for regular versus distance learning since both are coming online right now?
I think there are examples of either way. There are students who have done through purely distance education and have excelled in life. And there are students who have gone to the classroom and slogged for not 4 years, sometimes taken 6 years also, because sometimes they have backlog papers and they have not been able to do well also. So both examples exist. So I think commenting on that is not right now. What is more important is your attitude to learn, your commitment to learn, your passion for learning. I think these three attributes are more important whether you are in the classroom mode or in the online mode. I talked about various faculty development workshops which we have conducted, I said earlier, hundreds of them and huge number of them. If they were not interested at all and they have just registered for getting a certificate and finally to get a promotion, and in the face-to-face mode also, they will do the same thing. They will not learn anything. They will just come and give attendance and then finally finish it off. And therefore, I think that commitment, passion, attitude is more important than whether which form of education is important. And therefore, I think my only request to all who want to succeed in life or want to upskill themselves is put in your hard work. Don't depend on what is the outcome or result, what others think. Don't think about that. Think about what you want to do, and to achieve that, what all you want to do, you must put in your full 100% into it. That's all.
Great, sir. There is an interesting question on the same on the MTP. Are you planning to conduct any kind of teachers or probably faculty development program to align themselves with latest technology and trend? This is a question from the audience.
But I have already answered this, that we have this under.
It's a future academy. Planning. It's coming as a future planning so that they can be aware of, because a lot of people are not even aware.
We are going to hold 500 workshops, each with about minimum not less than 200 to 250. So I think it's a massive teaching learning which we will do for teachers, train the trainers kind of a thing, and then we will expand it further.
Great. So my it's almost an hour right now, so I'll be having my last question, which I always ask, and since there's a lot of mentors are also here, the question pertaining to the schools. As I was mentioning that, the video is also going to be shared to the schools. So if I talk about India 2.0 and all, definitely there are a lot of expectation we do have from the students, both from school as well as these colleges. Now, school students are also coming up with a lot of innovative ideas. So what is, do you kind of, give some kind of light that, what kind of projects or innovative ideas students can think? It can be sanitization, it can be something related to testing, it can be something related to AI, whatever it is. I'm sure the mentors who are here and the recording, whenever it will be broadcasted, I'm sure the innovative ideas can be guided by the mentors for the further proper channelization. Over to you, sir.
No, I think New India expects that we have to start engaging right from childhood our students, in terms of whether it is values, whether it is in terms of teaching them the emerging new technologies, and there is a lot of power in them, and that power has to be used. So we used to conduct actually hackathons for quite some time. AICT has mastered the art. Actually, we had 3 hackathons, and the fourth one was in pipeline when suddenly lockdown has happened. And now even hackathon we are holding in the online mode. We already had 2 hackathons which were conducted. One was called as Ideathon, the other one was called Samadhan, exactly for COVID-19 crisis, whether it is development of some of these tools like PPE kits or masks or sanitizers or ventilators, all those medical equipment were talked about. Now, the third one is going to be launched by the Prime Minister's office, called as Drug Discovery Hackathon. So how do we discover drug? It's not necessarily only for COVID-19, which is an immediate challenge, but in any future, not only endemic or any type of activity where we require to develop new drugs, how our university college students can really pitch in and then help us. And it's a big resource which we have not been using so far. So now R&D means only in the large industry or some R&D IIT like institutions or Indian Institute of Science, etc. But it can be done right from school level. And there are some concrete examples. These Atal Tinkering Labs themselves, you must be knowing better than me, that they have created certain things which are phenomenal, which you cannot imagine by an engineering graduate or even in an industry person has not thought of. Such solutions come from young generation. I think we must give opportunity, and school level hackathons are possible. Innovation committees and councils in every school is possible. And how do we build linkages? And this is another area which I keep talking often, that we are all segregated. Education is a continuum. It is lifelong. It starts from our early childhood. That is, when child is 1 year old, he starts or she starts learning from the mother, then father, then the siblings, and then nursery, KG, school. We have divided, this education to KG, then primary school, high school, secondary high school, then we have college, university. The same fellow is going all through. So you have to have an absolute continuum. And that continuum in terms of not just education, but all variety of co-curricular activities. And therefore, whether in the school, if you have some course on gardening, agriculture, going into the nature, going to the mountains, I think this should become part and parcel of our education system. And if you do that, you don't have to do anything. They will do on their own. Things will emerge automatically.
Great, sir. I think probably we can have one more round where we will be only talking about the innovation. Probably we can have a nice panel as you were mentioning about New Zealand. So we'll talk offline and we'll see how we can build a nice session in future. Thank you, sir, for your valuable insight and time.
Yeah.
I hope you enjoyed.
Yeah, I enjoyed, and there were wonderful questions from the audience as well as you. And whatever little I know, whatever little experience I have in my life so far, I wanted to share so that our younger generation is really empowered. We must make use of it. They are great.
Awesome,
younger generation is better than us. We should compliment and accept it. That acceptance is most important for all of us.
In fact, this was quite helpful. I'm sure the mentors who are sitting here, that they will be passing this to the schools they are associated to. For the audience, we have tried to cover all the questions, but definitely, as I was mentioning, keep following us. We'll be having sir in one of the another session where we'll be building up a nice platform, and you will be notified on that. Sir, I hope you enjoyed around an hour. You are bearing me.
I hope you also enjoyed. My enjoyment is fine, but you also should have enjoyed.
Sir, it was. Kabhi ek ghanta chala gaya, pata hi nahi chala.
Dono ka happiness important hai. Yehi humko school se padhana hai. Main khud happy hone se nahi chalega. Main dusron ko bhi happy karna hai. Vasudhaivam and sarve janaha sukhino bhavantu are the real, parameters which we should embed right from school to the higher education.
Agreed, sir. Agreed. Thank you. And in fact, I'm immensely happy with the session. And for the audience, let's continue the journey. We'll be back in next week again. Stay tuned. Stay at home. Be safe. As I always mention, keep learning and see you all soon. And let's all learn and control manage. Sir, thank you once again. We'll have a talk offline for the further session.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you very much.